today, we're going to teach you a hardcore skill, how to truly train a Flux Kontext LoRA. And this LoRA is not just an experimental one. Let's take a look at the effect of this LoRA. This is a standard Flux Kontext workflow. I've added the LoRA I trained here. Please note, the name of this LoRA is 3D Box Toy. You can think of it as a 3D doll placed inside a box. Its trigger word is, make her to a 3D box toy. Then, let's look at the effect. A real person, transformed and placed into a box. Of course, this might not literally be called a box, but you'll notice the character has a 3D-like effect, which is very beautiful. Even more beautiful than a real person. To demonstrate the generalization ability of this LoRA, let's try another example. Take another look at this. It's also very beautiful. First, let's briefly introduce our tool, called AI Toolkit. This tool is extremely powerful. It can not only train Flux Kontext LoRA, but it can also train all LoRA models you currently see. Therefore, the application value of this software is quite strong. Furthermore, you should note that this training tool has a UI user interface front-end, which makes it relatively easy to use. Next, let's talk about dataset construction. Flux's training dataset is different from traditional LoRA training datasets. Traditional LoRA training datasets only require a result image. For example, if you want to train a character, you just need various images of that character's forms. However, Flux Kontext LoRA requires a pair of images. The first one we call a control image, and the second is the result image. This is because Flux Kontext primarily focuses on learning image editing capabilities or image transformation capabilities. Therefore, it needs to know how to transform from an original image to a target image. Currently, there are three methods for constructing such datasets. Cascades of multiple Flux Kontext models. For example, the effect I'm demonstrating now is achieved through this method, involving two steps of Flux Kontext sampling. We first use our prompt, change image, to 3D CGI chili style, which transforms it into a 3D bobblehead doll effect. After generation, I performed another sampling with the prompt to transform the character into a miniature landscape, toy, and place it inside a box, which resulted in this effect. This entire process is quite stable. Let's try one more example. In the first step, we transformed it into this effect. Then, in the second step, we placed it into some kind of box, achieving the final result. This way, we obtained a pair of images. This is the first method for generating datasets, which is relatively simple. Direct editing using photo editing software. For example, the famous big head training effect was created by simply using photo software to enlarge the person's head. I can demonstrate this by using the smudge tool to lift eyebrows, make one eye larger and the other smaller, and shrink the face inwards. This way, I can generate a target image. This is the second method. Reverse operation using Flux Kontext. If someone particularly likes animated style images, I can use Flux Kontext to transform them into a real photograph. When we use it, we take this real photograph as the control image and then generate the animated one. This method is generally used more for style transfer. These are the three different methods for constructing datasets that you need to master. Note that it's currently an anaconda-like structure. In the current home directory where the tilde symbol is at the beginning, we can type LL, which stands for list. You'll see a directory called AI Toolkit. This is where the software is located. Then, we navigate into it. I haven't set this to auto start, as I believe everyone needs to master some basic operations and maintenance knowledge. It has corresponding start commands. Go into the UI folder and execute the command. It states that if you need a password, use it, as not using one means anyone might access it, which isn't secure. Therefore, we can use a password. Since I'm on Linux, this method works. I'll copy the command, go into the UI directory, right-click, and you can set the password to anything you like. For example, I'll set it to 123,456 and press enter. Okay, now it's successful. Note that the access port is 8,765, but the IP address is not this one. This is an internal network IP. We need the external network IP. We write it here. HTTP, external IP address, 8,765. Press enter. Enter your password. 123,456, and press enter. Okay, now we're in. The most important part here is dataset construction. For any training, we need three datasets. One, control images. These are our original images without any style applied. Two, Target dataset images that have been truly transformed into your desired style. 3. Intermediate testing. After a certain number of steps, we use these to perform a test to check if the effect has achieved your desired result. I'll reconstruct 3 datasets. Let's look at the first one, the control image dataset. You can name it anything. We click on new dataset, then write a name. For example, I'll write box toy CTL, then create. Now, this dataset is constructed. We can add images. Please note, try to ensure these images are in JPG format. Their naming has a specific rule. They must contain a unique number, similar to 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Then we can upload them. These are the original images, so there's nothing else to say. Next, let's create the second one. Similarly, we click New Dataset. I'll name this box Toy Data 1. Then create, add image, upload. At this point, we need to upload a dataset. Similarly, try to ensure all are in JPG format, regardless of their names. They must also have a numerical part. And this numerical part must correspond to the control image. For example, if one here is the girl in the maid outfit, then when you go into your control images, one must be its corresponding original image. Make sure they match this way. And here, you need to write a prompt. This is the prompt you want to use to transform it into this style. So, here I wrote, make her 2 3D box toy. Since they are all girls, I can write it like this and paste it everywhere. If there's a male, change her to him. Next, we need some test images. I'll call this sample. You can call it test 2. In the middle of training, it will take these images and perform a test. For example, let's create another one, which we'll call box toy test. Try your best not to let these images appear in your training data. So, here, we'll directly upload a few images that have never been used before. This way, the dataset construction is complete. A very important thing next is that we now need to configure something, your Hugging Face token, because it needs to use the Hugging Face client to download models. This speed is very fast. Models need to be downloaded, so you need to configure your own token. This is very simple. I'll explain how to set it up. Go to the Hugging Face page, then log in. If you don't have an account, register first. Then, click on your profile picture. Go to Settings. Then, select Access Tokens. This is very sensitive content, so it will ask you to enter your password again. Confirm login. At this point, this is the token I previously set. You can create a new one yourself. I recommend everyone to directly create a read token, meaning it's read-only, as you just need to download models. Then, write the name here and click Create. I won't continue with the demonstration. Then, paste your access token here and click Save Setting. Make sure to click this. Don't just fill it in without saving. That won't work. A very important point next is that we need to create a new job. Click on New Job and give it a name. For example, I'll call it 3D Boxboy V3. And note, you don't need a trigger word. As we mentioned earlier, it can train not only Flux Kontext models, but you'll find that it can even train Flux N1 models. We select Flux. We can keep this default. For the rank value, we select 32. The rank value can be thought of as the rank of the matrix that is trained, i.e., how many rows and columns. If it's 32, the trained model will be approximately over 300 megabytes. Below that is the training configuration. You generally don't need to change much. We suggest everyone to increase the learning rate a bit. This way, during gradient descent, the effect will be more apparent at the beginning. I think 2 would be better. Below are the datasets. For these datasets, we must pay attention. The first one is to select your target dataset, and the second is to select your control dataset. So here, we select Box Toy Data 1, and here, we select Krentar L1, because it's clearly asking you to select the control images below. Additionally, you should note that if you have a 24GB graphics card, remove 1024. Some people ask why such a large VROM cannot run it. This is because, during training, it concatenates these two images together. So, if you concatenate to 1024 images, it effectively becomes 2048. Therefore, to be safe, we recommend turning this off. Below is the intermediate sampling. This refers to how often we perform sampling during training. Please note, we sample once every 250 steps to check the generated effect. Then, which images do you need to sample? These are the 5 images we uploaded at the end. Here, there are corresponding prompts. We've already shown you our prompt, so we can write, make people to a 3D box toy. Then, for the control image address, specifically the CTL address. Some people ask, How do I find this address? It's very simple. Open this dataset. Be careful. Hold down the shift key, otherwise it will jump away. Open it in a new window. Then we open this test, copy its address, and paste it. This is the first one. You can completely copy the rest. Of course, below are the second, third, and fourth ones. Then we can create this job. After creating it, you can also edit it. I suggest everyone to increase the number of steps a bit, especially for our current training scenario. We change it to 4,000, then click Update. This is how to modify the task. After modifying it, we can then start it. Clicking this will start it. Now you can see Start Job. First, it needs to download the model. However, I have already downloaded this, so if you use my image, you won't need to download the model again. If you were to download the model, it's approximately 45 gigabytes. Therefore, you need to ensure your network connection is smooth and make sure your access token is correctly configured. Now, it's starting to load the model. Everyone, notice, we've encountered an error. This indicates that one of our configuration items is incorrect. We can go into the configuration items to check what's wrong, because it needs to generate a baseline sample first. Usually, the problem is here. Everyone, please note, you might have seen it. This is CTRL. I configured it as CTL, right? Then update job. We'll run it again. Okay, next. It starts a baseline sampling. What is baseline sampling? It means that without adding any LoRA, we just use our prompt to directly generate an image. This is baseline sampling. Now, the baseline sampling is complete. Let's look at this area. Please note, there should be 5 images. These 2 were extra samples from before. I accidentally stopped it. Everyone, take a look. Without any LoRA applied, we can now roughly see that they have a basic 3D effect, right? Some have this box effect, but, well, it's basically in this state. Then, it will enter its training phase. Everyone, take a look. The training speed is quite fast. And note, in this task, we configured it to resample every 250 steps. So, let's wait a moment to see its next sampling. Look, the first 250 steps have already been reached. Now it's starting to resample and generate images. Please note, in the second sampling, the box effect has already started to appear, right? Further on, it's basically this kind of form. Everyone can directly see at which step it can finally achieve your desired effect. So, I won't continue training this. I'll stop it now. Let's directly look at what I've trained before. This one was also trained for 4,000 steps. I completed its training. We can look at the final training effect. Just look at the samples. This is quite neat, with 5 in each row, because I trained with 10 images. Actually, 10 or 20 images are both fine. The effect is basically guaranteed. Everyone, take a look. This is the first time. Then, further on, the box effect starts to appear, with each step being 250 steps. Then, all the way to the end, everyone, take a look. The 3D effect also starts to appear. Then we can go into the overview. It will keep the last 5 models. So, this is the last one. We can download it and then use it normally, like any other LoRA. In this final section, let's talk about the environment setup. If you're not very interested in this aspect, you can skip it. And today, we're talking about the complete environment setup on Linux. First, we need to clone this repository. Then, we create a virtual environment. Of course, I'm using Anaconda here, but it uses VENV. We need to pay attention that the PyTorch version it installs is 2.7. We can check my CUDA version. I'm currently on 12.6. So, how to install 12.6? I'm currently on the download page for 12.8, but you can find 12.6 through the archive page. Then we start selecting. Note that I'm currently using the Linux x86 version. As long as you have an Intel CPU, it's x86. And we are currently using the Ubuntu version. Then, note your specific distribution. You can check it this way. LS-BIR-LS-A. I'm currently on 22.04. So, you can select this. And everyone, try to choose network installation to keep your network smooth. Then, just install it, command by command. Additionally, after installation, we need to set up environment variables. This is the same as installing on Windows. After installing, you need to set environment variables, but the method is different. You can click here, it has installation instructions. And inside, there's a section called post-installation, which explains what we need to do after installation. It has environment settings here. We need to write this into your test directory. Generally, we directly modify the .bashrc file. Let's briefly look. In the current home directory, where the tilde symbol is at the beginning, we can directly vi edit it. Note the dot at the beginning, .bashrc. This file usually exists. Then we press enter. And you should notice, I added a line here. Actually, it's to add the CUDA 12.6 I just installed. Specifically, it's bin directory, the directory containing executable files, to the environment variables. This has the same effect as on Windows. On Windows, after setting it up, you also need to modify environment variables, right? After modifying, remember to restart the terminal for it to take effect. So, that's the CUDA installation. After that, it's very simple. You can just use this method to start installing PyTorch. But, you need to note, it's also using 12.6 here. So you're installing 12.6, right? So, you can just use this command directly. After installation, just like we installed the requirements before, next, we need to install Node.js. We can install it according to the official website. Search for Node.js, then click on it. I'm clicking Get Node.js directly. For the version, choose the latest. Then, select Linux. We are not using Docker for this. Choose another tool. Here, we select NVM then. At this point, you can install it according to these instructions. After installation, the entire system will be usable. So, there are roughly these few steps. Firstly, install CUDA. Secondly, install AI Toolkit. For this, you need to install a virtual environment, download the repository, install PyTorch, then install the required dependency packages. Then install Node.js. Okay, today's content was quite extensive. I hope it was helpful to everyone. That's all for today. Follow me to become someone who understands AI.